My name is Christian. I'm going to be building a timber frame structure that's going to serve as a proof of concept for a house I'm planning on building in a few years. We're going to start with this,
to this,
to this, to this. Let's get started. Today we've got a slight change of scenery. I've moved a lot of what I'm going to be working on in the next few days over to this area by the garden, and actually where the structure is going to eventually be. So as you can see, I've got a few of the short posts done. Those are going to go there, there, and there. And I got partway through the third one and realized, huh, this is the last one, I should probably be recording this. A little bit of a snack there. So what's happened so far? So the first thing, before even doing any of the layout for the joinery, is coming along and see if I can find one. Go on this one and see, that's a signal for ground, and that is a line. So what we did is we stood up the center post there, and all of these are now numbered, stood up the center post, used some of the scrap wood to hold it in place, and then used a water line, which was just a piece of tube from our maple syruping setup, going from 1 foot off the ground here to 1 foot off the ground to each one of these other posts. So we'd get the center one set up, have someone watching the water level, set up another post here, bring the water level over, and make sure that it was this side was where it needed to be, and mark this side. So hopefully that kind of made sense, but long story short, getting a level line for all these, because these are off by up to an inch or so, which is kind of fun. But it's the first time doing concrete for me, and this, the fact that they're in the right positions in the first place and haven't wandered too much, is a success in my book. I've got the long posts over there. You can see one of them's hand here, and I'll be cleaning that one up a little bit more. But that'll be that's actually the center one. And then I've got the rest of the posts over there. So hopefully that'll be the next video. I've got to finish these pieces, get them fitted, make sure that I've actually finished the joinery properly. I haven't done as much cleaning up on especially this and those. That is a 2x6 hole and an 8x6 hole for a 2x6 and a 2x4 plus wedges in both areas. So we've got our standard layout marks here, just because these ones are a little bit interesting, where I've got stuff going at 90 degrees to each other off the story pole. On most of these, I've been writing what exactly this thing is, so when I'm going through and doing it, I'm not forgetting something, or it's another sanity check as I go through the process. Let's see. What else to talk about? I've been doing these just using this handsaw. It's not set up properly for it, but versus getting the big saw set up and in position, it's kind of nice to use this one for a change. A little bit more work on the arm, but it is what it is. Some of these pieces are checked pretty well. I actually did this side first just to see if I can even use this post for this, and see if I can come under here. Hopefully not give anyone vertigo. It's good enough. When this goes up into the top plate, I'm going to be putting wedges here and here, which will spread this out. So even though it's a little bit scraggly here, this should serve as serve well enough as a tenon. So that's, I think, about it for the intro. Let me set the camera down and get to work. Well, that's fun. So somehow I managed to that last segment. Definitely not a cinematographer by any stretch, or anything even close to that. Just a pretty good rant on rhubarb and some other delicacies. I might get back into that in a minute. Actually, I've already got this crack running here, which means that if I'm popping this way, so I actually want to do it here, 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 and here, which means I'll just be able to pop these pieces right out of there. At least that's the theory anyways. This one's a little bit close to this nice feature in this log, this piece of knot. Some of these pieces would actually make nice furniture, all things considered, but I have enough other nice ash to mill up to make furniture out of. And to let it sit and dry for many, many years. Who knows, seeing that this is ash, maybe 50, 100 years, someone will take the structure apart just for the ash, to reclaim it, so to speak. Who knows what'll happen with the ash tree in that time span. Ash borer's doing enough of a number on it here. Say, at least half the trees on this property are dead. Trying to leave any trees that may or may not be resistant to the borer. But I'd say I've taken down maybe one or two trees in the whole project that were anywhere close to healthy, but three quarters or more even have just been really no hope for that tree. Right on through. I'm thinking this mortise will be the last for today, and then I'll record the 2x6. It's actually a 2x8 hole tomorrow. We'll see. Also falling a little bit behind on editing at this point. See, I've got the top plate video, king post video, one or two other filler videos. I actually took a nice video, which hopefully will be posted before this one, of the ash borer. Do I even need to put the ash borer? And let's see if that's in a better position here. Yeah. Actually, it was even one of these pieces I was cleaning off the sides. This one is actually pretty square, but the other two had to remove a lot of bark and a little bit under, and I actually found almost completely developed ash borers in there. I mean, don't get me wrong, they're beautiful little creatures, but they absolutely destroy these trees. So there's no love lost for me on smushing them or feeding them to the chickens. I'm actually sure if it's good to feed them to the chickens, but I figure chickens get access to enough weird bugs and critters that they know reasonably well what to eat and what not to eat. It's probably getting close to 5 here. I have been out here doing this all day. So I am starting to slow down a little bit. I've got to finish this piece and then six of those posts each, which have way too many mortises. I did a little bit of analysis before putting the footers in just to check my math. And the structure itself will probably come out to only about 2,000 pounds, which is actually not that bad. I think the heaviest piece is close to 400, 300 to 400. Still don't know how that one's going to get put in place. I guess that's the weight of the frame is 2,000. So with the siding, stuff we're putting in it, it'll come up probably about another 1,000 pounds or so. I'm actually, even though we were doing it for a completely different reason, I am glad we did that, because now I can estimate how hard it's going to be to get every single piece into position. Quick snack. Also, bottom of this one, that right there, there's probably a bug somewhere within here. So, I want to be careful as I eat down the rhubarb. I also mentioned this in the last segment, I've not been talking about rhubarb. I'll talk more about it in a minute. These chips are heating up, and so is the bit. So I think in the past when this was cleaned or sharpened, this was taken down a little bit too much, so I think I need to file down, at least clean up this edge here, so that it does not rub against the side of the hole as much, because this is should be the extent of the hole, and this should be slightly smaller. And to be clear, I'm not an expert on these augers. This is my own particular interpretation of how I think they should be sharpened. But these faces on this one seem to be doing pretty well. I could probably stand to bring down the back of this, because it looked like this one was sharpened on the back flat, which impedes its cutting ability and means that this some of this surface I know is dragging as it's digging into the wood. The auger on this one, though, or the bit, the screw, that's what I'm looking for, on the front, is actually in really good condition. This is the hardest to fix. I have one that I want to try refiling or recutting. I don't know. I don't even know if that's possible. This one, I have not touched the screw. And if you're new to this stuff, if the tip of the screw is broken off or bent or anything's wrong with that, move on to the next one. The wings, sometimes you can get away with fixing them a little bit or sharpening it a little bit differently, but the screw itself, if that's not in good condition, I have not had any success trying to fix that. And if it wasn't clear, I'm just stalling because I wanted to take a quick sec before hopping into the next hole. A little bit. I can technically overlap these holes a little bit, but I found that it tends to get a little bit stuck, and I put it's less work to bore the hole normally and then pop out the little space between than it is to fight with this and have it go trying to work its way off center. No, I'm kind of curious. If you know, answer in the comments. Did anyone ever make a reverse threaded screw? Because right now, a lot of effort is going this way. It'd be nice to be able to alternate every hole going in different directions. This one, because I've got that crack there and I know it's going toward the center of that check, I should be able to just lever in that direction and pop pieces out. That was my rough theory. Let's see how close to that is. If I made a mistake. No, it looks like that does work. So I've already got almost one of my edges there. Goes a little bit far here, but close enough for this project. So on the other side, spent a good bit of time talking about rhubarb, which is that weird stalk looking thing. And I guess I'll try and paraphrase some of that. Grows only in certain climates. I found it's actually somewhat regional. I did not know until I moved to Maryland and could not find rhubarb. And whenever I mentioned it to someone who was native, they were like, rhubarb, what's that? Sort of fruit, vegetable, or mineral. Actually, come to think of it, don't know if it's actually a fruit or a vegetable, technically. It's probably a vegetable, but it's used like a fruit. But it is kind of like the flavor of an apple mixed with the flavor of a lemon with the consistency of celery. So if you like chewing on celery but hate the taste, you should try rhubarb. See, common uses include jams, preserves. Actually, I don't know how much about preserves, but I definitely know jams. And pies, definitely. Cobblers, if you're really into it. Actually, come to think that I should make myself a nice rhubarb cobbler. It is prime season right now. Pairs well with strawberries, especially. Most people around here are familiar with strawberry rhubarb jam, strawberry rhubarb pie. But not as many people eat it with blueberry, but it's actually quite delicious. I don't know how many people actually call it this, but we in our family, we tend to call it bluebarb. So we'll have a bluebarb pie or some blue barb jam on some biscuits, which now that I say it out loud sounds in a different context. It just sounds like a made-up word. Blue barb, what the heck is that? And most people will not make a straight-up rhubarb pie with no other fruits in it. I, on the other hand, not most people, and like rhubarb enough that I will, I mean, as you've seen, I've just been munching on a plane. Just grows in a stalk. The big leaf on them. The leaf is not edible. Well, I don't think it would kill you. I would not recommend eating it. It's full of oxalic acid, which is actually what you use to treat bees for mites, funnily enough. I don't know how they get from plants or... And they probably just synthesize the oxalic acid, but it's, as far as I know, it's the same compound. Mm. Not that it was particularly sour. It tended to be sweeter toward the leaf and the things in. That one was like biting into a lemon. Actually, I'm not sure if it's more lemony or limey. It might be more limey. As much as mortising is a bit of a pain, it's very satisfying popping out nice large chunks like this. This ash is beautiful wood. I've got to use it for more stuff. Well, I still have access to it. It's kind of sad, the fact that most of the ash will be dead within, at least within this area of the Northeast, will be dead within, I don't know, I can't imagine it'll be around for another 10 years, given the rate of die-off. But the elm is already pretty much gone here. We've got, if I look hard, I can probably find some elm saplings here and there, but no long-standing trees. So all the elm that I have access to is dead standing. And I should find sections that haven't been too worm-eaten yet. So this piece, just a little bit checked, had a knot in it, but overall was actually pretty solid wood. I made some hammers out of some pretty buggy elm, and that stuff just ended up crumbling. That was a waste of time. But it was pretty good practice for making hammers and working with very crisscrossy grain. I should come stand up here. That'll be easier. So, I think I said this on the other side, but didn't actually record it properly. When I'm doing this, I'm angling in because it's pushing the chisel toward this side, because it's not separating directly from the side. So, it's a technique to keep it mostly going straight. And again, this is a mortise for a 2x4 and not actual joinery. So, the amount I care is limited. But, oh, speaking of which, this is actually a real 2x4, not a go to Curtis or Lowe's or Home Depot, and it's like, oh yeah, it's a 2x4. No, it's so much less. I get that they dry it and then they plane it. It's a planed, it's, I don't know. Just seems like nonsense to me. Call it a 1¼x3 if that's what it actually is, not a 2x4. Didn't actually hurt. getting hit by that. It was more of the surprise mixed with getting impacted by a piece of wood that was preemptively saying, ouch. That felt pretty good. Chisel, for as old and rusted as it was when I found it, actually holds one heck of an edge. Must be the steel was of good quality and properly tempered. There's some writing on it, but I've not been able to discern what exactly it is. But given how much I've used it on this project and seeing how little I've had to sharpen it, it's still got quite a lot of life left. There's no cracks whatsoever in the lamination where you've got the bluer hardened steel here. You kind of see a line here. When I soaked this in vinegar to clean it up originally, it actually etched and blued a little bit the hardenable steel there. And you can actually see, as I've been working on this, you can see that area right there is hardened steel, and this is the mild steel. And it looks like a little bit of an artifact where that was the hardened steel actually shifted over there. So there's a little bit of mild steel there, but overall, not bad. It's kind of fun to cut these little accordion pieces out like this. I also just realized I should have been clearing out through here and actually just dropping the chips out the other side, but I got distracted and didn't actually clear out the wood. Oh, and I've got that stuck. Come on. Clear out the wood that was separating the two sides. That. There we go. That's going to be much easier to work with. Yeah, this is definitely going to be the last thing I do outside today. My main day job is sitting inside and typing on a computer all day, which is, it's lucrative, but definitely does not help me keep in shape. So doing this project, I'm in better shape now than I was through most of college and the years after. High school I rode. Actually, I do want to build and sell rowing shells at some point. I don't think I've actually made a video on that, but I have posted on Reddit, links to a build video. Hardly anyone makes rowing shells in the U.S. And there's a good number of clubs, especially around this area, that just use old refurbished hardware for their schools. But they're old canvas designs, which are really hard to maintain. Where, as I think I found a nice compromise where it's a wooden strip shell, but it comes apart into sections and makes for easier transport. And you can, because it's all wood, it's a hair heavier, but it's pretty strong, and if you break it or ding it, you can either just re-varnish it, or I guess rather re-urethane it, or glue it back together, or just buy a new section. Oh no, you dropped it and you crushed the bow, or I don't know, million, you hit a bridge abutment. Well, instead of replacing, how about you replace a part? Which especially makes sense when you start adding the multiple modules together. And you can put in multiple C-segments in a single boat. So one day you can take it out as a single, next day take it out as a double, and even take it out as a quad at some point if you're up for it. If I did my math correctly, the buoyancy works out for at least a quad. Might go up to an 8, but structurally at that point I'd be a little bit worried about the flexibility of the boat. I might try it at some point, but I've got to finish this project before I can get back to any of the other ones. It's also one where I need a workshop for. And depending on what happens with the pandemic, either the top of this will become, top of this structure will become a workshop, or I'll go back to where I work and got access to a workshop up there. Funnily enough, where other people build boats. Some skin on frame, some strip, lots of different techniques. If you're interested in getting into boat building, the best recommendation I can give is do a skin-on-frame kayak. Buy one of those kits. You can put it together in a couple weekends. Just have to learn how to tie one new knot, learn how to do one stitch. That's a little bit of sanding, a little bit of elbow grease, and you've got a little bit of painting. You've got a fully-fledged kayak. I saw a bunch of designs online, then I just kind of made one up. As a guess, and it's not the most streamlined design, but it's served me pretty well. They're pretty tough, and the biggest thing is they're super light. Like, I can lift the whole kayak without much trouble at all, carry it around. I don't like the big plastic ones. They're nice for if you're doing something where you're going to be rock scraping a lot, but the skin-on-frame ones are just so nice to just portage around. One thing I haven't done that is on my list is doing a skin-on-frame canoe, because a strip canoe is a good amount of work. I did build a strip kayak at one point. I did not like that. The strip rowing shells are nice because they're simple curves without too much bending. Strip-built kayaks a lot, so skin-on-frame kayak is a little bit more bending work and building a kind of a ribbed structure on the inside, but it's very light, very strong. Come on. So, we'll see if that's my next boat project or if I get back into building rowing shells. I've got to find... The hardest part about that is not actually designing and building rowing shells and making that profitable. It's figuring out the insurance and the business liability. Because nobody else really in the U.S. makes wooden rowing shells. There's people who make wooden kayaks, and I've contacted some of them. But nobody's had a straight answer on... But I'm looking for insurance on a business that does something that is potentially dangerous like that. How exactly do I do that? So, to be fair, I have not spent a bunch of time searching, but that's the next obstacle to overcome for that particular project. But I've got time. Lakes aren't going anywhere. Neither's the Mohawk. I should clean that up more because it's bowed a little bit on the inside. I just want to go in and have dinner, but I really should finish this. Just wrap it up and not have to worry about it. I'm also careful not to put my feet under this, and you've probably seen instances where I've done so, but I very much try not to do that, because if I hit this and it gives way and goes right through, that's a toe. Especially when you're working with a slick, which weighs a heck of a lot more. Keeping all of your digits both high and low is a priority. Though funny enough, I don't usually hurt myself with the tools. I hurt myself by accidentally punching into the wood and hitting sharp corners there. Back when I was working on another project, before I had a good cover for the drone, I've ended up slicing tips of my fingers pretty well on a couple occasions. But now that I've got a pretty good cover on that, I'm good. Like, as crazy sharp and as dangerous as the draw knife is, as far as just a sharp instrument moving at relatively high speeds, I've been more likely, or historically more likely, to hurt myself just getting it ready to use instead of actually using it. Alright, let's see that. Sides. And we're done for tonight. I'm just gonna switch over to the slick. That's so much better. So, one thing I'm not entirely sure about is, that was fun. Putting this mortise here in relation to that tenon, I mean, the load on this is going to be that way and this way. So it'll be supporting this way and be tightened in this dimension, which should be fine, but having these two joints close together is a hair worrying, but I think it should be fine. Too far in. There we go. And the same thing. Have no idea when I'll actually be back in the office proper, given how things have been going, trying to reopen stuff in different states. I'm perfectly content to work from home for a while. A few more time for projects and the like. Don't get me wrong, I do like actually going off and seeing people I work with and enjoying the fantastic food in the cafeteria, which is actually not sarcastic for once. But I don't know. I do enjoy the human interactions, but having some alone time as well is also kind of nice. I'm hoping... I guess my ideal situation is working from home a few days a week and being in the office a few days a week. And now there's a nice horsefly or black fly. I don't entirely know what's buzzing around my head. That is good enough for now. I come back later and do another pass. But I think I'm officially worn out for today. Finish up this. I've mentioned this before, but this is not necessarily what a slick is for, but it works really well in this application, getting inside of the mortise nice and clean. Shaving down just a little bit here and there. There. That looks pretty good. So, that's all for today. Hopefully, see you again tomorrow morning when I finish up this piece and then start work on laying out the large posts, long posts. All right. It's now much cooler. It's the next morning. And getting into the last mortise on this piece before it's pretty much done. I think one thing I should get is a smaller whetstone, or at least get a whetstone that I can crack into smaller pieces. Because I have not been able to properly sharpen this. You can see that it's actually makes pretty good chips, but could be a little bit better. Just been sharpening it with a saw file here and there. Still kind of wish they, well, I don't know if they do or not, but have these augers left-hand threaded. I think you could switch back and forth. So at this point I've got to decide, do I try and fit two holes in or just put one in and then chisel out either side? I think I'm just going to go one in the middle and do a little bit more chisel work. That should be all right. Thank you. see if this is a bad idea or not. Put this here. Technically, I could probably, at least in this one, I've got enough meat to drill here and here, but the bore there and there. This isn't too bad. So we got some good mosquitoes out here this morning. Try splitting some of this away. should be far down enough. Other side will be easier. I can just push these right through. Be good enough for the center for now. about to die. To take a quick break. Alright, to take a little bit of a break there. Get the extra battery for the camera. This edge, and we're good to flip. Pretty good. Let me just take those out to the look at anyways. As I'm doing this, I'm trying to mentally prepare myself for all the mortises I'm going to need to do in the other six posts. So each of these has two mortises each. And let's see, one of the posts, the longer one, has just two mortises, one small and one large. One of them has three. Two small and one large. Ooh, I'm going in a pretty good angle here. I need to pay attention. Let's see, two next to that are three small, one large. And if I've done my math right, and I probably didn't, I've got one, no, I've got two with, just three small. I don't think I've done any of the, what I'm calling small mortises yet, so I'm not sure how hard those are going to be. These ones are a pain, again, because I don't have the right size auger. So I make do. But the smaller ones are just this auger in a line. And then chiseling out the stuff between. So I think those are going to be a little bit easier. So that's at least what I'm hoping. So I've got three more of the 2x4 mortises, which ends up being a 2x6 hole. And I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 16 or 17 of the small mortises. But those are also not as long. They're only about that long. So that'd be three to four holes, depending on how closely I can space them. Isn't that bad? And we'll see who else around I can recruit to help with this. Actually, I only have really this auger that works well. For this one, I bought a few that I just have not been able to tune up right, slash have been had parts broken off of them, like the, especially the lead screw. Or either that or the lead screw's been damaged. But the boring though tedious is not the majority of the time on this. At least that's not the sense I get from having done a bunch of these. I guess there is worse wood to mortise than ash. Ash at least is pretty consistent. Oh, come on. Should I try for two on this side? See how that works? That would be about there. I don't really have enough room for that. Hey, catbird. I think that's a catbird. Right up to the line. hand. Split this nice big chunk off. That was I admit that is quite satisfying. In pretty good shape. It's good enough shape to bring these ends up a little bit. Thank you. I gotta take out of this wall. I'll do that after I get that side done. If I was doing this in pine, I'd have to be much more careful because it likes the cracks like to spread up through here. Still got a little bit of an ash, but this ash especially has been pretty resistant to splitting as I'm doing that. Take a little bit of a larger bite. That is almost exactly lined up with the other side. Just a little bit of cleanup. This part's done. That's the wrong way to come out. See if I can push this off of the sawhorse and onto my foot. taking up just a little bit too much more than I can chew on this. There we go. Good.